Humanity has always been changing. But what is occurring now in your world is that the rate of change is accelerating. More and more people around your planet are moving into meditation in its various forms. Why? Very often, people feel desperate enough, not being able to manage their lives or the stress in their lives, that they're looking for something to ease the stress and the tension, and they move to meditation.
I'd like to welcome to the show Prageet Harris and Julieanne Conard. How are you doing, guys?
Doing really well, and it's great to be with you.
Thank you so much for coming on the show. I am really fascinated with both of your journeys into channeling and the work that you're doing with the Stargate, as well as the entities that you, the group that you channel. We're going to have a little bit of a live channeling later on in the conversation. But first question to you guys were, both of you, what was your life like before this insanity that is channeling came into your life?
Well, it really felt like insanity at the beginning. Well, for me, this was way back in 1988. I was with a group of people living on Maui, and we were looking at buying a hotel and turning it into a healing center. So we were working on that, and one day we were at my home in the living room having a business meeting, and I was totally exhausted. And my friend said, hey, why don't you just lie down and let us give you a massage? So I was actually lying on my living room floor with several people massaging me. And I went into this very deep, relaxed space, and it was wonderful and timeless. And after some time, somebody was talking, and it was a bit of disturbance, but I was just enjoying the massage, and the talking got louder and louder, and then it was too much for me, and I opened my eyes, and when I did that, I realized it was me that was doing the talking, and my friends were saying, you were channeling. I said, no. And they said, yes, you were, do it again. And I closed my eyes, and it started to happen again, and I'm a really skeptical person of all this kind of all the different new agey things. And I wanted nothing to do with it back then. But they kept on asking and it kept on happening. And so I was alone in my room at one point, and I said, if this is real, who are you? And I heard loud and clear, Alcazar. And I thought, well, that's such a weird name. It's not the kind of name that I would make up. But being a really skeptical person, I really didn't believe it. And so what started to happen was, as people said, you know, do it again, Alcazar came through and he started to tell them things about their earlier life when I didn't even know them, things that had happened to them. And they would say, wow, how did you know that? And then he went on to say to people, well, in a day or two's time, this is what's going to happen to you. And when it happens, call Prageet. So I started to get calls from my friends saying, well, Alcazar has said it's happened. So slowly, slowly, against my own better judgment, I started to trust what was going on. And the more I trusted, the more relaxed I felt, and the more information and clarity started to come through. And it was really, it took me a long time to totally drop into it. And it was after about a year. And in that year, what started to happen was more people would come, and Alcazar would start guiding meditations. And they were very powerful. They took people very deep. And after about a year, he said to me one day, we want you to build a structure. It's called a Stargate, and it's going to be an interdimensional doorway. And I had no idea what an interdimensional doorway was. And so he gave me a picture in my mind, and we have one behind us here. And he said, we want you to build it. I said, okay, but it's very complicated. And what are all those angles and lengths? And he said, yes, but we want you to build it. And I said, well, I need some information. And he said to me, if you start, you'll remember. And that just felt like really weird to me. But by then, I'd been working with him for a year and trusting more and more. And so I went to Home Depot and I bought a bunch of copper tubing. And the strangest thing was that I just knew intuitively how to do it. And the first one I made was 10 and a half feet high. And when it was put together, it started to create this amazing energy. And then Alcazar said, just ask for it to be activated. And when we did that, the energy got really strong. And he said, what's happening is that this geometrical structure is actually an anchor for a higher dimensional consciousness to be here. And again, my skeptical mind, that doesn't make any sense at all. And he said, well, it's the same as your physical body. Your body enables a higher consciousness to be here. It's just a very different form. And I said, well, okay, I kind of accepted it. But as we've worked with it over the years, it becomes very clear that this structure does have a consciousness. And when we do groups with it, it responds to each person in the group in a different and very unique way. And the doorway that he talked about, an interdimensional doorway, what starts to happen in the meditation when people are relaxed, they start to connect into many of the different realms, the angelic realm, the ascended masters, and even like the unicorns and the dragons that some people have experiences with. It enables people to connect into what's appropriate for them in the moment. And it's really fascinating the way it's been working. And I was working doing this for quite a long time until, when was it, Jules? I connected with you. 2012. When Jules came into my life, also quite magically.
So, Jules, how is it for you?
So, I actually studied molecular biology in college. So, this was like a total...
Right down the street. Right down the street, obviously. Yeah. You learned this at school, obviously.
Yeah, clearly. That's what we study in biology class. Yeah. So I was actually like just fresh out of university at UC Santa Cruz, and I found the Stargate on meetup.com. And like, honestly, I was just looking to meet friends. I was moving back to my hometown. And I suddenly, like, I must have ticked a box for being interested in meditation, because it was like the Stargate was just there. And there were two keywords that got me to absolutely want to experience it. And it was high vibrational energy fields used for meditation. And I was like, oh, I got to go check it out. I had just done reconnective healing with Eric Pearl, which was like my entry point into metaphysics and channeling. He read a channel and I was like, whoa, channeling is real. Like, I had never even thought about it before. It was like grouped with like crystal balls in my mind, right? I'm like, all right. So I'm like, wow, there's like this wisdom dripping from this channeling. And I was like, I want more. And so I went to this evening in Placerville, California, and there are probably like 9 or 10 other people there. It was just in someone's living room. And I walked in, like I opened the living room door and the Stargate set up inside, and it was like some kind of wind blew me backward. And I was like, okay, something interesting is going to happen. And I was walking down the hallway before the thing even started when I saw Prageet's face for the first time, because he wasn't on the meetup profile. And when I saw his face for the very first time, like this feeling washed over me that I've never had before or since. And it felt like deja vu, but like I was remembering the future. And it came with these three feelings, like my whole life's about to change. I'm going to travel the whole world and it's going to be the greatest adventure I've ever been on. And like this smile popped on my face and I was like, okay, like I hadn't even experienced it yet. I was like, we'll see what happens. And so basically that evening I had my first Stargate experience, and the way that the meditations are channeled, Alcazar is basically introduces you to like the angelic realms, for example, or ascended masters, for example. And for me, I was like, whoa, because when I did the reconnective healing seminar, it felt to me like there were like angels all around me, like whispering in my ear that like life is like this cosmic joke, but in the best way possible. This is like just pure lightness. And Alcazar is like, okay, now we're going to call in the angelic realms and like feel the angels. And I was like, oh, those were angels. Like they feel the same. I knew it. So basically, I think I've been a feeler my whole life. And my mom tells me when I was like really little kid, I was just super ethereal and knew things about people without having any way of knowing them. So for me, Stargate was kind of like the coolest thing I'd ever experienced. And yeah, slowly we realized like there's all this cosmic connection. And like Stargate came through Prageet in 1989, and that's the same year I was born, for example. So we basically discovered that I have a connection to this work and to the guide Alcazar, and I've been working with Prageet ever since.
Well, how did you guys, both of you, how did you deal with this channeling psychologically when it first hit you? I mean, energetically and psychologically, because from my understanding, when you're channeling other beings or groups of beings, it's a very high charge energy. And if your nervous system is not primed, you can blow that circuit. So one, how did you deal with it energetically if you weren't actively preparing for it? And secondly, psychologically, this kind of goes against, you know, like you said, Prageet is very, you know, you're very skeptical of all this stuff. How did you just had to kind of wrap your heads around this when it first came into your lives?
Well, for me, it actually is very easy, because even though I'm really skeptical and still am to a great extent, the way that Alcazar works with us, it's really nourishing. It's not like being used. It's by being supported. And that's very different. And yes, when I'm channeling, there's a lot of energy that comes through. And that's part of the process, that's sharing the energies with the individual, the groups that we're working with. And so over the years, as I've allowed it more, it's like the channel or the energetic availability gets stronger and stronger. And what I've found, and what the responses that people have said to me, is that sometimes you look like you're actually growing younger. And there's definitely that feeling inside me, more youthful, more energy, more excitement about life. And the way that the guides work with us is that they start making connections which seem like coincidences or accidental connections, which are actually just guided meetings to support what we're doing, moving out into the world even more. And right now, we're touching thousands of people. And I think right now we have over 50 different countries where people are working with the Stargate. And it's not like we're going out advertising it everywhere. It's just mainly word of mouth. And I feel so supported. I feel like I've got a lot more time for myself now than I ever had in the past. And I certainly don't have that high level of stress that I had when I was trying to buy a hotel.
Fair enough.
Yeah, we're very different. So for Jules, it's different.
Yeah, I mean, for me, when I first started channeling Alcazar, I actually was on Maui, which is interesting because that was the birthplace of the Stargate. Mm-hmm. And this was, I was like early days. I was just volunteering with the Stargate, and like Prageet and I didn't really know each other that well yet, but his friend told him that he should call someone and get them to come out and help because he was really stressed out. So I get this phone call on Christmas Eve of 2012, and Prageet's like, "Jules, I'm really stressed out. I'm on Maui. I need help with this computer work. Will you come out?" And I was like, yeah, I'm like, sure. I'm like, you know, I had time then. I was just out of college. And so I was like in this kind of empty space in my life. And so I go out to Maui, and the very first time we were taking a break, and just like, I was like, hey, let's meditate with the Stargate. And so we're just sat next to each other. And Prageet suddenly looks at me. He's like, "Whoa, what's happening?" And I was like, "What do you mean?" And he says, "I feel Alcazar's energy all around me, and I've only felt it from the inside before." And Alcazar's our guide for the Stargate. And to me, that was the first confirmation I got. Like 3 months later, after that first like super conscious moment where I was like, I know this guy somehow. Like, so I was like, cool. And so for me, it was like a grand adventure, to be honest. Like when I was first channeling, it would feel almost like this like space helmet of energy would come over me. And I would say it never felt like there was any kind of like danger of blowing circuits or anything like that. Mm-hmm. Like it felt like this exquisite, almost as if there's like a bubble of higher consciousness and knowingness that would come and sort of like interface with my mind.
It's interesting working with Alcazar, because sometimes when we're guiding a group, he will come through me, and then he'll switch and go through Jules, and then back to me. And occasionally I start a sentence and Jules will finish it. But very often I know exactly what she's going to say in my own mind. But the beautiful thing is that when it's coming through me, it's coming through a male energy. Mm-hmm. And when it's coming through Jules, it's a feminine energy. And so the emphasis and the feeling is slightly different. And that's another beautiful, subtle way that he works with us.
Julieanne, it sounds like when he was going through this transformation of becoming a channel, he seems like he was a farther along in his life, and seemed like the group around him was very supportive. Is that a fair statement, Prageet?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay. But for you, Julieanne, you were just coming out of college, and I'm assuming you weren't raised with a bunch of channelers around you. So what was your family, your friends, your colleagues? How did they deal with it? And how did you deal with them dealing with this pretty out there, you know, thing as far as channel? Because it is much more mainstream than it was in 2012, but it's still, you know, it was pretty much on the outskirts of metaphysics, to say the least.
Oh yeah, the lunatic fringe.
Yes, yes, sure. exactly.
For sure. You know, I'm lucky because you're right. Like, my parents were both very scientific people. My dad's a doctor. My mom's been a nurse and an accountant. And
oh God, Jesus.
Yeah.
I can only imagine the conversations at Thanksgiving dinner the first time this came up.
You know, honestly, like, it was kind of flowy because before I even for sure knew I would be working with the Stargate and channeling and all of this, I brought my mom to an Earthkeeper conference in Arkansas where Prageet was doing Stargate stuff, and we both volunteered. And that was, again, December of 2012. So she got to see 600, 700 people from all over the world, like, coming together and being interested in this kind of stuff. Yeah. So my mom was really supportive from the start. My dad's like, "I just want you to be happy." So it was kind of okay. I told them basically I was doing an internship. I was like, I'm gonna go, you know, like, learn and see where this takes me. And I'm gonna, like, Prageet started traveling in June of 2013, and I got to go with him. So it was sort of like, You know, I think my parents were kind of okay with it. I don't know, like maybe they expected me to do something kind of strange from the start. But yeah, there weren't really any obstacles, but yeah.
Okay, good. Well, so let me ask you, how do you guys balance this, the spiritual side of what you're doing with channeling and the work you're doing with your kind of day-to-day life as a human being walking through this planet? You know, you have information and understandings that many human beings on the planet don't understand in regards to our own soul, our spirituality, why we're here, lessons we're supposed to learn, humanity's general journey as well. So you have a deeper understanding of all this, but then yet you still have to wake up and like, I gotta brush my teeth. Oh God. You know, like how do you, you know, gotta take another shot. I gotta make sure I gotta eat, because if not, this damn thing is gonna fall apart. You know, this kind of stuff. How do you balance between that knowledge of what you have as a channel and what you've been able to obtain and this day-to-day kind of walking through life as a human?
Well, one of the gifts that Alcazar brings is it's very much about living in the moment, being content and enjoying what's going on. And so very quickly, when I started this, it developed into a lot of traveling around the world, creating a newsletter. So it became a full-time job. And the joy of having Jules come and be with me was that she's very skilled in that whole area of computers and all the different programs and so on. And I'm a dinosaur as far as that's concerned. And I, you know, I type with two fingers. Like
I type with two or three, not too far from you, my friend, but I understand.
And so our whole life is this work. And so when we're not actually doing the workshops, we're planning, you know, where we're going to go next year and what countries and which, and sometimes we take groups on tours. We were just in Egypt with a large group of people. And then we went on to Greece, where we had over 1,000 people in person and a couple of thousand people online with us as well. And that whole process was something that Alcazar guided to actually, this might sound a bit weird, but to actually change the timeline of humanity for each one of us individually, but then as humanity as a whole. And the idea or the concept, or, and from my point of view, the reality of it, is that the whole of humanity is connected by what's often called a morphic field or a morphogenetic field. So we don't feel it, but energetically, we're all, without exception, connected to it. And the more that each individual raises their consciousness or their vibration, they actually affect the morphic field. And although individually we're just a drop in the ocean, when there's a large group of people all with the same intention and meditating together, it's amplified. And there's been many scientific experiments to actually recognize and affirm that that's what's happening. So when we had 1,000 people all meditating together in person with all those other people supporting us online at the same time, we created a huge wave of energy around the consciousness of humanity. And it's not that you can demonstrate that this worked, because you never know where we were heading before this new timeline, so to speak. So it sounds a bit
presumptuous.
Yes,
to say something like that. But the thing is, I've been working with Alcazar since 88, and he's given me so many demonstrations that I totally and absolutely trust what he's saying, even when it seems like way out there. And there's been a number of demonstrations, a very beautiful demonstration I can tell you about. We were in Bulgaria with a group of people, And we created a very strong energy work with the Stargate. And we actually, what one of the things he does sometimes is ask people to project their energy into the Stargate, and the angels and other guides bring energy to them, and then they project it into the Stargate. And we did that, and we built up the energy in the Stargate with the intention of supporting all the new children. Because Alcazar was saying it's very difficult for children being born in this density of unconsciousness. Some of these higher energy children that many people are aware are coming into the world now, he said it's very difficult for them. And so we sent out this wave of energy just to support the new children. And it felt really great. But then after a minute or two, suddenly, there was this huge wave of energy that came into the room. And we were all going, wow, what was that? Because we were just kind of sat there relaxing. And Alcazar came in again. And he said, what you just felt was a response from more than 100 children from different places around the world who felt what you radiated out to them, connected together. They sent you that energy back. And that was just, I get goosebumps just remembering it. It's like there's demonstrations that happen, which if you're looking on the outside, it might not seem like anything special. But when you're in it and experiencing it, it's quite magical. And he has a wonderful way of guiding us. And another example that's coming to mind right now is we were in Israel in a very large theater there, guiding a workshop. And all of a sudden, the fire alarm goes off. And Alcazar says, relax, it's a false alarm. And then after a few minutes, somebody who was organizing our workshop came running in and said, you've got to leave, you've got to leave, there's a fire. Come on, go out. Alcazar says, no, relax, it's okay. It's a false alarm. And the bell is still ringing and people are beginning to look a bit nervous. And then somebody from the theater came running in and said, you have to leave now. There's a fire somewhere. Come out. And again, he said, relax. And so we were there and half the people were kind of relaxed and half the people were ready to run out. And then a minute or two later came and the alarm went off and the guy from the theater came back and said, you can relax. It was a false alarm. And it's like things like that. It's like it takes a lot to allow that to come through whilst fire alarms are going off.
Well, let me ask you guys, what are some of the core teachings of Alcazar?
That's an interesting question because it's really all about becoming more conscious, becoming more aware of your own self and more aware of the subconscious programs that we carry, which are actually limiting our life. Our subconscious works about 100 times faster than our conscious mind. And so many of the decisions that we think we make during our day is actually made by the subconscious rather than your conscious mind. So more and more, as people move deeper into this, it's about recognizing the habits and the subconscious programs, finding the root cause, which is very often in your childhood, seeing it, understanding it. And then when you have the certain aha moment of, that's why I do this. I don't need it any longer. And it literally falls away. And you can see the change happen in people's faces when they let that go. And it's gone. It's gone for the rest of their lives then. And they're, from that moment on, they're a little bit more aware. Their vibration is just that little bit higher. And when your vibration moves up, even just a little bit, reality changes. You become more conscious, more aware, and more of a conscious creator in your life. So it's about becoming a conscious creator. It's about discovering who you truly are.
Yeah, I would say for me, the most impressive thing about the Stargate work is that it opens your direct channel to experiencing subtle energy. So this is how this device works. It's how it's an interdimensional doorway. Is it actually like creates or emanates a high vibrational field that actually vibrates our energy field, and somehow our human nervous system OS is actually designed to be able to perceive these energies. It's built into our system. So the Stargate's a bit like people who don't feel subtle energy usually can, like 95% of people can feel these energies. And so it opens up your own direct experiencing of the beyond. And that's different for everyone. Some people have inner vision. The most common is feeling. Prageet and I are both mostly feelers. But it's like, it's beautiful. So it gives you direct access to higher states, to like what could be called flow states, or essentially like time moves differently. You can feel every cell of your body vibrating. Like you can kind of like access these like liminal spaces that otherwise can be very difficult or take years and years of meditation to go to.
And that's on one level. The other level is very physical. It's like people have been in these meditations and their body changes. It's like cancer disappearing. There's a very powerful story about a woman that happened in Germany. She was a nurse and she had an accident on a bicycle, banged her head and stopped breathing for a while. And they brought her back, but she was blind. And she and her husband came to a workshop over the weekend. And in the break, in the lunch break of the first day, I was walking down a corridor and she was coming the other way with her husband. And Alcazar popped in and he said to her, "When you are ready, you can see again." And I would have thought she'd be really excited about that. But no, she got really, really angry. "How can you say that? The doctors have told me I'm going to be blind for the rest of my life. You're a spiritual person. You shouldn't be doing things like that." And she stomped off. And as she left, Alcazar said to her, "Who do you choose to believe?" And on the Sunday, again, it happened in the lunch break, she came up to me and said, "I choose to believe I can see again." So Alcazar came in and he told her, "Go lie down in the Stargate, close your eyes, stay there throughout the lunch break. When we come back, when the group comes back, we will do a meditation. Just stay in the Stargate." So that's what happened. We did a meditation after lunch, had nothing to do with her. And at the end of the meditation, she opened her eyes and she could see again. And Alcazar said, "Now you can see 95%, something like that. This is what you have to do to bring the rest of your vision back." And so things like that happen.
Wow.
It's not something you can decide. The person has to be totally open to letting go of whatever was the cause of that particular physical problem. But there was a Swedish girl that was deaf in both ears, got her hearing back over a weekend. There's been many people with curvature of the spine where the spine has gone straight. In Switzerland, there was a lady who came into a workshop and she said, I've come to this weekend because I have to go for a hysterectomy on Monday and I just want to get a little bit of calmness and peace before I go into the operation." And Alcazar said to her, "If you just relax over this weekend, you won't need the operation." And sure enough, by the Sunday evening, she felt so great and her body felt really different. She actually called the hospital and canceled. So her physician called her in and said, "Why did you do that?" And she said, "Well, I don't think I need it." And so they did some more tests. And when she went back for the results of the test, the doctor said, "You know, I'm terribly sorry. They must have got your results confused with somebody else. There's nothing wrong with you." Things like that happen.
So let me ask you guys, what is the process of channeling Alcazar? For you, I know you guys are trans channels, if I'm not mistaken, correct?
No, we're conscious channels.
You're conscious channels. Great. So then can you explain to the audience, when you do the channeling, what exactly is happening?
Mm-hmm. Well, it was different in the beginning. In the beginning, when it was very new for me, I would have to kind of close my eyes and kind of really relax myself and invite Alcazar in. And I could feel slowly my energy field shifting as he came in. But now he's around all the time. He's here now. And mm-hmm. he can pop in any moment. And so it's just becoming familiar with the energy. And your concern that you mentioned in the beginning, well, how do you deal with that? He's such, I'd call him a he, but it's really a group of beings. But he's so respectful and honoring.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the things that we occasionally do with a group of people who are relatively new and uncertain about, oh, what's going to happen if I invite these guides in? One of the things that we do sometimes is invite the guides in. People can feel the energy around them. And then we'll say to them, now ask the guides to go. And what that demonstrates is that as the energy goes, it shows people that they're in control. They're not being subject to something. Mm-hmm. They can invite in and they can ask it to go. And when people realize, oh, it's up to me, I can just call the angels in. And I can trust it, because if I don't feel nervous or something, I can ask them to go and they go. And so that's a really beautiful understanding. It's about nurturing each one of us wherever we're at. Whatever problems we have, whatever challenges we have in our lives, the guides are there to support that.
Beautiful. So can we do a little bit of a channeling session and ask a couple questions to Alcazar?
I don't see why not.
Let's do it.
Okay.
As I said, he's always around.
All right. So my first question is for Alcazar. How do you define the coming shift that is happening in humanity?
Beloved ones, we greet thee. 'Tis Alcazar. And as we talk with you, the words that we share with you are to occupy your mind. But in truth, the gift of our words is that they carry a gentle, supportive energy. So as you listen to the words, relax also and see if you can feel the nurturing energy that we bring to you, if you choose to receive it. So, to answer your question, humanity has always been changing. But what is occurring now in your world is that the rate of change is accelerating. More and more people around your planet are moving into meditation in its various forms. Why? Very often, people feel desperate enough, not being able to manage their lives or the stress in their lives, that they're looking for something to ease the stress and the tension, and they move to meditation or yoga, which is a form of meditation, or the many other potential ways of helping relieve the stress of your daily life. So as more and more people move towards that inner silence, that inner relaxation, then they move into a place where they are more creative. They do not necessarily realize it. But what is happening is people are wanting a change in their lives. They are wanting more peace. They are wanting more abundance. They are wanting more freedom. And as their minds focus on those things, spirit in its many forms responds. And so humanity as a whole is creating the acceleration. as more and more people want a different way of life. As you are aware, over the previous centuries, there has been a very male-dominated perspective on life. The male has dominated the female. There are many, many different countries who have dominated others. And that has created so much suffering. And humanity as a whole is wanting to move out of that. There are those powers that be, so to speak, want to maintain that control. It is very profitable. They do not want change. But as we have said before, you are all connected by the morphic field. And so the more and more people who are wanting change, who are asking for a higher way of living, their energy, their combined energy, is getting stronger and stronger. And so the frequency of control is getting less. And they don't like that. And so they are trying to find ways of actually dominating more. And you've experienced that over the last couple of years. And you will find that there are more and more attempts to maintain that old status quo. But, beloved, there is too much energy of change. There is too much energy of desiring love, compassion, peace. Or, as many like to call it, the light versus the dark. There is so much more light happening now. It is not that these are bad and these are good. No, it is all just vibration of consciousness. And so one of the biggest things that we say to each and every one of you is stop judging. Stop judging the other. Why? Because the energy of judgment is a lower vibration. If you wish to have more love, more peace, more compassion, more freedom, stop judging. Even those that you might say are doing terrible things, stop judging. They are just as much a product of their conditioning as you are. They have been less fortunate and receive conditioning that is very different from yours. If you can stop judging, you raise your vibration. You raise the vibration of the morphic field. And so even then, those in the lower vibrations are affected by the higher energy. And slowly, slowly, those who have been very dominating in the past with a very heavy consciousness, they too are being touched by the raising of the energy. The transformation that is happening on your planet is about to accelerate even more. There are technologies that are available now on your Earth to give you what's often called free energy, energy from the quantum field. There are technologies to provide water for everyone. There are already technologies that can heal the earth, the land, the soil very rapidly. In 1 year, poisoned soil can be brought back into productive, growing, healthy plants. There are so much that is available to you. And raise your vibration. Move into meditation. It will assist you and assist humanity bringing in the new more rapidly.
So, beloved, humanity is at a great crux point. It is at a place where, as you can see, so much of your future trajectory depends upon these coming years. This is why we say, invest in yourself. We have said before, the greatest contribution you can make to making the world a better place is to love yourself. It is to raise the frequency of the consciousness here. And we have also said it is not even about light versus dark anymore on this, your planet Earth. Now it is about oneness versus duality. And you can see the divisiveness that distracts, that keeps people fighting amongst themselves, and how it is used by the powers that be to keep you from focusing on the greater good of all. And so you can see that as higher consciousness emerges here, the veils of forgetfulness that keep you distracted and fighting amongst yourselves can start to lift, and you see very clearly the challenges that are before you. So we invite all of you hearing these words to take a deep breath and to relax and to move into the center of your beingness. For it is from this centered place that you can move forward far more clearly. Because humanity's future can indeed be far brighter than perhaps you think.
Could you provide insight into the human suffering currently resulting from the ongoing wars that are happening around the globe?
Beloved one, let us give a different perspective. Those behind the scenes who are trying to direct humanity are concerned. Because they live in separation, because they do not understand the potential of humanity, they look at the world and they say, we cannot continue like this. There's too many people here. And their solution? We have to find ways of limiting the number of people. Warfare is a great way of doing this from their perspective. But warfare is also a great way to finance and to build their own coffers. Because this creates a demand for weapons. It creates a demand for hospitals. It creates a demand for medicines. And they're all created by the same small group of people. So we do not wish, as we say this, to create anger or frustration. We just wish to give a perspective. The wars that are happening on your earth right now, if you would ask people, how many wars are there? And they might say, oh, well, there's something happening in Israel and Palestine. And all I remember is there's something going on in Ukraine. Beloveds, right now on your earth, there are almost 100 different types of warfare happening right now, one group against another. This is not something that Alcazar is pulling out of the hat. It is coming from a research group in your Switzerland. So, why is this happening? In order to create the continuation of the old, separation is needed. As long as there is someone to argue against or fight against, the energy, the consciousness stays low. You will find that there are more and more attempts at creating these conflicts. It is happening. They are being provoked. around your world. There are many in Africa right now. Why? Because Africa has a great potential. It is a vast land, mineral rich, and there is much opportunity there. But there are also many people there. And so it is a way of reducing the number of people. Another way, illness, plagues, or viruses. There has been many different ways of controlling. But this time has to be over, beloveds. This time can be changed by moving into love and compassion and dropping your judgment. Judgment of the other. Judgment lowers the vibration. Start looking at the other as a product of their conditioning and have and hold compassion for them. These wars have a positive effect, if you wish to call it that, because people who are suffering and people who are watching the suffering start to say, I no longer want this. And when they start to say, I no longer want this, their focus is moving away from judgment, wanting peace. Peace is the coming together. And so there is an upside, if you wish to see it, of warfare. It starts to create more and more people around your world wanting, praying, asking, meditating for a new way of being. And so even though there is so much suffering happening, there is a light at the end of the tunnel. The way for each individual to move towards their light is to become more conscious. And there are many forms of meditation. Sitting with your eyes closed, cross-legged, is very old. Humanity is evolving. Those techniques were very useful in your India, in your Far East. But for the Western mind, something else is needed. That is why the Stargate was given to humanity. At this point, when acceleration of consciousness is about to happen. For many, many, many lifetimes, consciousness has been very, very, very slowly growing. Now it is going like this. You are on the cusp of a great change of consciousness. You are bringing the low frequency and the high frequency closer and closer together. When you reach that place of oneness, then your consciousness starts to rapidly rise. And there will indeed be a whole new earth here. And it is far closer than you might think.
Mm. Now, how will artificial intelligence or AI affect our spiritual growth as a species, as humanity?
So this is a beautiful question, beloved one. And we would say your artificial intelligence has great potential. It is simply mirroring, again, the overall consciousness of humanity. And so your AI can be used to power great leaps in technology. And of course, it is already happening. Perhaps more than any other technology, its uses in your immediate future will depend on the intent and the level of consciousness of its designers. So, for example, it can be used to power the most massive surveillance states your globe has ever seen, or it can be used to power great humanitarian efforts. And in the current probability field, both are still possible and both will be occurring concurrently. However, some of the more controlling potentials are being diverted already. This is why we say this is a flux point, a great crux for humanity, your current years, because all of these rapid accelerations in your technology are happening now. And in a sense, new systems are being developed. And so as these new systems are being built brick by brick, so to speak, at a certain point, the foundation will be set, but it is not set yet. And so right now, our message to you, those of you who are listening to this particular podcast, is to vote with your attention for the uses of AI that are brilliant. Go out and find the ways that this is being used to power the betterment of your world and raise your level of consciousness. Again, we cannot emphasize this enough because, beloveds, you are all in an ocean of consciousness. You cannot see it yet, but you are all connected. And so the more you lift up out of duality and separation into a state where you are connected to the oneness, the more you fuel realization, direct realization of higher consciousness in those who perhaps are not meditating at all, those who perhaps are busy creating those foundations for the future of humanity.
Do you, and finally, Alcazar, do you have any final messages for the audience?
Beloved ones, perhaps the most important thing to know is that you are not alone. There are many in unseen realms. The angelic realm, for example, we say the angels because for many, many centuries, many of your religions are aware that the angels and the angelic realms exist. There are other benevolent beings assisting when you ask, assisting you individually, and assisting you as groups, communities, and countries. Be aware you are never alone. Allow yourself to reach out to other like-minded people so that you can feel the support of others. One of the biggest problems in your world today is that people feel alone. People feel alone even in their own family because they feel separate. They do not think that their family operates, feels, senses in the same way as they do. Families are arguing, fighting, creating separation, even in the family group. Find those like-minded people. How do you do this? Just by asking for it, intending for it to happen. There is a force in the universe. You can call it God if that works for you. Whatever name you wish to give it, there is a consciousness which, when you ask, responds to you. This one, Alcazar, is just one of the many voices of this consciousness. Here, simply to support your awakening, your ability to sense that you are far more than you know you are. You are all creators, but you create unconsciously. Our effort, our aim is to assist you in discovering how to create your life in a conscious way, to start drawing into your life that which you need moment by moment, be it more love, more friendship, more abundance, more freedom to travel, more health, more amazement and wonder. All these things and more are available when you start to ask. Just ask inside, internally. Take a still moment and just ask for support. And strangely enough, if you keep asking, you will draw it into your life. Beloved ones, we are here. There are a myriad of support beings, conscious beings, seen or unseen, that can come into your life to support you. Do not be alone. Do not be in fear. You are loved.
And beloved ones, we would say to you all, do not believe everything that you think. You are far more than your thoughts. You are far more than this brain-mind mechanism, which has been tuned to this very narrow spectrum of reality, lifetime after lifetime. We would say to you, be open to the possibility of expanding your felt sense of who you are, expanding beyond the perceptions that you have had in the past. Be open to the possibility that the true nature of who you are can be felt, be known directly by you. And so we invite you to expand. We invite you to transcend yourself and to be amazed, because, beloveds, the true nature of your reality is that you live in a multidimensional universe. There are these unseen realms and dimensions, but do not take our word for it. Go out, experience this for your own self. Because, beloved ones, when you do, some very deep part of your humanness says, okay, I can relax. Some deep part of you starts to re-remember the enlightened being that you truly are, starts to reconnect to a sense that you live in a benevolent universe. And that form of self-assuredness is needed here on this, your earth, more than ever. And so we invite you to become an ambassador of oneness, not through the words that you speak or the knowledge that you seek, but simply by relaxing and opening to your own beingness and knowing that indeed all is well here. Things can change far more quickly than perhaps you imagine. So as you look upon your world and you see the amazing rate of how technology has changed since this one was a child and they were still the cassette tapes, And now you are pulling data from the cloud. Can you not imagine what the next 100 years will bring? So we say to you all, be hopeful, be bright, because you are connected to that light that is within.
That was a beautiful, beautiful session, guys. Thank you. How do you feel? How do you feel after a session like that?
Energized.
Super energized.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, it's a great gift what you're doing for the world.
Appreciate
it really that. Is, because by bringing in all these different viewpoints, it gives people a choice. Oh, I resonate with this. And then it gives them a direction. And so you're bringing in so many different possibilities and potentials that you're making something available for everyone.
I'm trying.
And I really, really appreciate what you're doing and the gift that you've given us to share.
And beautiful questions, by the way. Thank you.
Oh, thank you so much. Well, I'm going to ask you a few questions I ask all of my guests. What is your definition of living a fulfilled life? And by the way, it could be you answering or Alcazar. It's up to you guys.
Well, I think this is for us individually because,
yes.
I mean, for me, I feel I'm living a fulfilled life, but there's so much more potential. It's like living in joy and peace and a level of abundance. When Alcazar talks about abundance, he doesn't talk about just money. He said abundance on all levels. Mm-hmm. Abundance of love, abundance of friendship, abundance of freedom to move, abundance of celebration, on and on and on. And yes, abundance of money, which allows those things to happen. But when you focus on gratitude, feeling grateful for what you have, the amazing thing is it starts you to open up to more of all those other levels of abundance. And that's not just a woo-woo concept. It's a scientific fact that the vibration of abundance changes your physiology, changes the way that you approach life, and you start to open to receive more. So gratitude is a really big part of living a joyful life. It's not about what you have, what you own. It's about how you enjoy and how you love what you have. And it's so important to share.
Beautiful.
Yeah, for me, I would say Richard Rudd from the Gene Keys said it right. Like purpose, prosperity, partnership. So that's like foundational. Beyond that, truly, like a fulfilled life for me, I want to be on an authentic spiritual awakening. Mm-hmm. Like I think it's so easy to get fixed in a sense of self. And to me, being on an authentic awakening journey means transcending yourself. It means having access points to just basically like taking the frame of how you're experiencing yourself and just like chiseling it so it shatters. And you're like, whoa, okay, like I'm not that.
That's the personality you're talking about. Yeah,
sure. Like, I mean, it's like Jamie Wheel, another one of my faves. He calls it the cosmic etch-a-sketch. Like, you know, like whatever mm-hmm. you've been sketching in your consciousness, just shaking it so you can experience, like basically experience it dissolve. And then it's like so much falls off of you. And you're like, okay, that's not who I am. And so it opens this field of possibility. And beyond that, with the Stargate work, what we're really doing is creating a global community. We have like thousands of people who are following us really closely, who like we know personally. Mm-hmm. But what we're hoping to create with that is a new sense of community where it's not like, oh, let's live on our commune together. Like that's valid, but it's like things get stagnant, right? Like. Mm-hmm. So like what we're
that has and that has a history as well, by the way.
It's got some karma.
It's got some stuff going on there. Not all communes, but there's been a couple of movies made.
But we're like, so what would it be like to be able to go to Italy and like plug in with like hearts, like minds, and like go to right. wineries and hikes and like, what would it be like to have like a Stargate Airbnb where you could go like hang out anywhere in the world and go find people? Yeah. So like, these are the kinds of like abundance opportunities we're exploring.
And it's happening. I mean, we just did this gathering in Greece with like 1,000 people there, and about 200 of them were financially supported by the Stargate community around the world. Because there's some places where South America, for example, where their money is worth very little. Mm-hmm. And so we just asked, can you support? And we were blown away by the response. 200 people had their hotels paid for, the workshop paid for. People that were coming a long distance had help, financial help on for their flights.
That's amazing.
It was so heart opening. And that's the community, the global community. And we want to expand that. We want that to happen mm-hmm. around the world for everyone.
Same here. Yeah. Now, exactly. I'll ask you both, if you both had a chance to go back in time and talk to little Prageet and little Julieanne, what advice would you give them?
Well, I'll start with that one.
Julianne's deep thought.
I would say to myself, what you are becoming is absolutely amazing. Don't be worried about what people are telling you. Don't be worried about what's happening in your family. Where you are going is fantastic. You are supported. You are loved. And you are going to be blown away by the amazing things that happen in your life. And as I said that, I would expect the life that I've lived up until now to be totally different, far more amazing, and I'd be far more advanced on this journey of my life.
Fair enough.
Yeah. I would tell little Julieanne, I would tell her to love herself and to give herself plenty of time and to not give her power away, meaning to really carefully choose. And also, I would tell her that it's not her fault and not to take responsibility for everything that's going wrong in the family. And that nugget is for me very personally. Yes.
Beautiful answer. Now, how do you each define God or source energy?
For me, it's a vast consciousness that's beyond anything we can actually imagine. It's definitely not an old man with a gray beard up in the sky somewhere. It's a consciousness that created the quantum field. The quantum field is these minute little dots of infinitely small energy light. And from that, everything has been created. Everything in the physical realm and all the other dimensions, all the other universes, all created from that initial quantum field. And in the Bible, it's at some point it says, let there be light. Before the light, there was no thingness. It was just this consciousness of spirit, this indescribable energetic, which is creating and which is continuing to create through us. Because my feeling is that what Alcazar calls each person's superconscious self, or soul, people like to call it, or higher self, that exists beyond the quantum field, exists in spirit, in the void, as Alcazar calls it. And it's like, it's that indescribable, amazing, energetic, which is just pure love, pure consciousness. And we're all part of that.
Well said.
Yeah. To me, the clearest feeling I can get about what God might be is the one who's receiving the like feedback feed of all of the consciousness from every single sentient life form and possibly even every like coordinate of space-time in the whole universe. So God is whatever vast infinite intelligence is the witness of it all. And who knows what else that consciousness is doing.
Beautiful, beautiful. Now, where can people find out more about you and the work that you're doing in the world?
Our website is thestargateexperience.com. You can go there and find many, many free experiences. So that's the best way to follow us. And we do live streams all the time with people all over the world. And you don't need the physical structure to feel these energies. Like we said, it's an anchor for a higher dimensional consciousness. And the way that our guide works is actually by empowering people to use the power of their intention to go super deep in these meditations. But they're every single one of them creating the energy field for themselves.
Beautiful. And do you have each of you have a parting message for the audience?
What's happening in the world is changing. Don't be diverted by what you read in the newspapers, what you hear on your news, so-called news on your television. Tune in, find a higher source of information. And if you're hearing these words, you're listening to one right now on this podcast, follow your inner guidance, not that you see on the local media.
Fair enough.
Cool. Now I'm giggling because you're not talking about yourself, right?
Hey, I include myself in that, but I don't limit myself to that.
Yeah. I think my parting message would be find ways to embody higher consciousness and breathe and have fun with it. So we're all in it together now. Like,
I want to thank both of you so much for coming on the show and sharing your experiences, your knowledge, and bringing Alcazar into my audience's life. So I appreciate you and everything you're doing for the world, my friends. So thank you again for coming on.
Thank you so much, Alex.
So much. Much love. Bye-bye.
Thanks for watching. Click on one of the videos below to continue your journey, and don't forget to subscribe.